the genealogy of Jesus recorded in Matthew and Luke's gospel, and how Matthew begins his gospel with this genealogical account to show how Jesus is the fulfillment of God's promises to his people in the Old Testament. And then last week we followed that up by looking at how John opens his gospel by going all the way back to the very beginning of time itself, going all the way back to creation. Well, this morning we're following that up by looking at the opening to Luke's gospel and what he does just prior to giving us his genealogy. He doesn't begin where we might expect him to begin. He doesn't begin with the genealogy. He doesn't begin with Jesus or with Jesus's parents, Joseph and Mary, but rather he begins after giving his very brief introduction with Zechariah and Elizabeth. So that's where we are going to be looking this morning. So we'll be starting off here in Luke chapter 1, verse 5. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah, who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were upright in the sight of God, observing all of the Lord's commandments and regulations blamelessly, but they had no children because Elizabeth was barren, and they were both well along in years. And so Luke begins his gospel account, again, not with Jesus or his parents, but after giving his very brief introduction, he turns to this older, righteous, barren couple, unable to have children. And if you, again, recognize that the first century Jews, the original intended audience of Luke's gospel, were very, very familiar with the Old Testament, that they would have heard this and read this story thinking this is a very familiar story that they've heard before. And we'll get more into that as we continue on. Back to verse 8. Once when Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as priest before God, he was chosen by lot according to the custom of the priesthood to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time came for the burning of incense, all the assembled worshipers were praying outside. Then the angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife, Elizabeth, will bear you a son, and you are to give him the name John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take of wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth. Many of the people of Israel will bring back to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." See, Zechariah he's not just a righteous man, but he is a priest. And he's selected to light the incense in the holy place. And you might think that this is just maybe him carrying out his typical work duties. This is just his job. This is what he does each week. But when you realize that there are 24 different divisions of priests totaling about 18,000 priests serving at once. And this was a task that they would alternate. And that when you consider the 18,000 priests, this was an honor and a privilege that as a priest in the first century, you would have the opportunity to do once in a lifetime, if ever. So God chooses this instance. In fact, he governs and directs this instance as the occasion for him to make a promise, this promise to Zechariah, to fulfill, to answer Zechariah's prayer, Zechariah and Elizabeth's prayer for a son. And this is, again, as a good first century Jew, this would bring to your mind this familiar motif throughout the Old Testament that you've heard many times before of an old righteous couple unable to have children, God making this promise to them and then fulfilling it. And then God does amazing things through this promised son that is given. So you think of Abram and Sarai. You think of Isaac and Rebekah. You think of Jacob and Rachel. You think of Samson's parents. All of them, you have this righteous older couple where she is barren. They're unable to have children. And God makes this promise and fulfills this promise. All of these stories are stories of God making a promise and fulfilling this promise. And through this promised son, God does amazing things. And when you plug that into what we've been talking about, this background context of the 400 years of silence that Israel has not had a prophet in 400 years. And so there's just been this silence. And then all of a sudden, in this silence, God speaks in this powerful way to this old, barren, righteous couple in, of all places, in the holy place of the temple, through the angel promising a son. To a good first century Jew, this is exciting. And your anticipation is building and building that God is about to do something significant. He is about to remember his promises to his people. As we've been talking about in this series, that there are many promises that God has made in the Old Testament that up until this point, he has not yet fulfilled. And they know that God is a promise keeper. And so they're waiting eagerly for God to fulfill these promises. And now as a first century Jew, it's starting to get exciting that God is about to fulfill the promises of old that he has made to his people. And so you can see how, as a good first century Jew, John the Baptist is exciting. That when John comes on the scene and this promise of his birth is made, that it brings up this excitement and anticipation that God is about to do some amazing things and fulfill these promises of old. Back to 63. Actually, before I read this, so Zechariah the prophet, he comes out of the holy place, out of the temple after this promise that is made, and he struggled to believe the angel and said, "We're older in age and we can't have children. How are you going to fulfill this promise?" And because of that disbelief, Zechariah loses his speech until the promise is fulfilled. So you have this group of people, of worshipers outside the temple, gathered around, waiting, anticipating when Zechariah comes out. You know, it seems that they're wondering, why is this taking longer than it should? Maybe he heard a word from the Lord and they're eagerly awaiting Zechariah to come out and share with them. But then as he comes out, that he's unable to speak, and he starts signing And so again, you have this continued growing expectation, anticipation of what is God about to do. So in verse 63, Zechariah, the priest, asked for a writing tablet. As the family is gathered around arguing over what to name the son, this child that's just been born. And to everyone's astonishment, Zechariah wrote, "His name is John." And immediately his mouth was opened and his tongue loosed. And he began speaking and praising God. The neighbors were all filled with awe. And throughout the hill country of Judea, people were talking about these things. Everyone who heard this wondered about it, asking, "What then is this child going to be?" For the Lord's hand was with him. His father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come and redeemed his people. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. And he said, as he said through his holy prophets long ago, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our father Abraham to rescue us from the hand of our enemies and to enable us to serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, my child," speaking to John the Baptist, his son, he says, "you will be called a prophet of the Most High, and you will go on before the Lord to prepare the way for him, to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our Lord God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet in the path of peace." And the child grew and became strong in spirit, and he lived in the desert until he appeared publicly. So just like the other Old Testament prophecies to an older, righteous, barren couple, John the Baptist is promised to be great, to be a fulfillment of God's promise through the prophet Isaiah and the prophet Micah. And that he's set apart like an Old Testament prophet. He is set apart. He said that wine and fermented drink is not to touch his lips. He goes off and lives in the wilderness and dresses like a prophet as well, with camel's hair and a leather belt. And you can see as a good first century Jew that has been awaiting all of these promises to be remembered and fulfilled by God, that this anticipation keeps building and building and growing to the point that people are wondering, is John the Baptist the one that we've been waiting for? Is he the promised Messiah, the promised king, the Davidic king? And it's for this reason that, as we looked at last week, that John the Apostle, when he opened up his gospel as well and refers to John the Baptist and says, "John, as amazing as he is not the light, but he points to the light, witnessing and testifying to who Jesus is." Because there's so much excitement surrounding this man, John the Baptist. But as great and amazing as he is, he paves the way for Jesus. As amazing as John is, Jesus is greater. And John is great in that he prepares the way and points to Jesus. In fact, John himself says, "The one who comes after me is greater than I, and indeed I am unworthy to untie his sandals. Whose sandals I am unworthy to untie." And so John, when he comes back to Israel and begins his earthly ministry preaching repentance, preaching to prepare your hearts for the one who is to come after me. Prepare your hearts. In Luke chapter 3, verses 2 through 5, it says, during the high priest of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the desert. He went into all the country around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one calling in the desert, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. Every valley shall be filled in, every mountain hill made low. The crooked road shall become straight, the rough ways smooth. So John prepares the way, prepares God's people for who Jesus is and what he is about to accomplish. And that he gets them looking for the fulfillment. And one of the things that I just, if you've noticed that I wanted to focus on in this sermon series, is how Jesus is the fulfillment of Old Testament scripture. That, you know, sometimes people think of the Old Testament as being, that's back then. You know, we have the New Testament now. But actually, all of it, all of scripture is about Jesus. And that when Jesus enters the scene and they start to see that Jesus is the fulfillment of the Old Testament, it changes the way the people of God understand the Old Testament. And that when we truly begin to see and understand who Jesus is and what he has accomplished, we begin to see that all of Scripture, the Old and the New Testament, are about Jesus, powerfully pointing to him and to what he does for us on the cross. So the content of Luke's gospel powerfully points to who Jesus is and that John paves the way for him. But I want to take a moment to actually add to that, that Luke also powerfully displays from a narrative standpoint who Jesus is just by his organization of the material. That he starts his gospel with the one who prepares the way for the coming king, the Messiah, the Christ. So he starts with this prophecy of the birth of this one who goes before the Messiah. And then Luke transitions to narrate the prophecy of Jesus' birth. And then he goes back to the birth of John the Baptist, the one who goes before the Christ. And then he goes back to the birth of Jesus. And then he goes back to the ministry of John the Baptist. And then he transitions back to the life and ministry of Jesus. So Luke, just from a narrative standpoint, if you set aside the content for a moment, just by the way he arranges the material, is powerfully indicating who Jesus is as the promised Davidic king, the Messiah, the Christ who God's people have been waiting for. So both with the material and with how Luke organizes the material, he's powerfully displaying in content and order who Jesus is as the promised Davidic king, with the forerunner to the Messiah, Jesus, the forerunner to the Messiah, Jesus, and continuing on in that structure. And so this morning, as we look at how John prepares the way for Jesus, for the promised king, I want to ask you, is your heart prepared for the king? Is your heart prepared for the king? You see, Jesus is returning. And we are called to always be ready, to always be prepared. And it's so easy to get caught up in the stressors of life, get caught up in all the things that fight for our time, our energy, for our passion, for our focus. It's easy for us to lose sight of being prepared for the return of Christ and having our hearts in the right place. And so this morning I want to ask, is your heart prepared? Are you right with Jesus? And maybe you're here this morning and maybe you've never accepted what Jesus has done in your behalf. Maybe you don't have that personal relationship with him. Or maybe this morning you're here and you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, but maybe with all the things, all of the stress, all of the busyness in life, maybe you've lost that focus in your life. Maybe you've lost that power of that daily walk with Jesus and pursuing him daily. Well, this morning, I want to ask you, prepare the way. Prepare the way. See, John the Baptist, when he was preaching preparation for Jesus, he was talking to God's people. He was talking to the Jews. He was talking to largely the righteous ones. Yes, he did also talk to and address the Jewish leaders. But and his calling them to be ready, tied in with that was his call for repentance. And so this morning I want to ask you to however God might be calling you to respond in preparing your hearts, whether it be in repentance or just renewed focus and commitment to a daily pursuit of his will for your life. Or maybe it's accepting Jesus for the first time. I ask for you to be faithful to whatever God may be doing in your hearts and calling you to. Would you bow with me as I pray? Lord, we come before you and thank you, Lord, that you remembered your people, that you are the fulfillment of all of these promises, that, Lord, you have loved us from the beginning, that even while we were yet sinners, you so loved us. Lord, would you prepare our hearts? Would you rid our lives of any sin, of anything that might be hindering our relationship with you? Lord, anything that may be hindering our effectiveness, our impact, Lord, in sharing your word with others and living lives that reflect you faithfully, Lord. This Christmas season, I ask that you would grow us, that you would challenge us, that you would remove any obstacles, Lord, that are between you and us, anything that we've allowed to compete for our affection for you. We love you, Lord. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.